Thank you, Tim. And it is a great pleasure to be here. I don't think the man standing to my left needs a hell of a lot of introducing. 168 test matches, 41 hundreds during that time. Nearly 100 of them as the captain of Australia, averaged over 51 with the bat. As we stand here now, post your career and you're doing an amazing job as a commentator, do you now look back on 168 tests and think that you were pretty greedy?
I look back and think that I played about 40 too many. I think I told you that out there earlier. It was obviously a childhood dream of mine to be good enough to play one single great game for my local club, and then be good enough hopefully to play a game of cricket for Tasmania, obviously my home state. But to look back now, 30 odd years post a lot of those dreams, and to think that I played 168 tests and I think it was about 375 one day internationals as well, it was a pretty good ride. A lot of great memories, a lot of great friends I met along the way, and a lot of parties as well.
Were you always going to commentate, did you think, when you were playing? Was this a path you were always going to take?
No, to be honest, I don't think I was ever that good in front of a camera or with a microphone in hand. But no, look, the things you talk about there are a long, long time ago now. And I've been retired for 5 years and loved every moment of the commentary journey that I've sort of started on through that period of time. The Big Bash was just a whole lot of fun working with a group of guys that Dave Barham put together there. It was just like sitting around in a pub and watching a game of cricket and chatting amongst our mates. But we had a lot of fun doing that, and I think I've come a long way as far as the commentary side of things is concerned. I've had a chance to work on a bit of test cricket as well, overseas broadcast stuff, but I'm really looking forward to having the opportunity with Channel 7 this year for the Australian public to be able to get a bit of a listen to what I've got to say about the test game as well.
When you were in the dressing room, obviously many of those tests as captain, did you have a different view of the commentators? You used to get annoyed with what they said. How did you go?
Well, you were doing some of it, yeah. So we generally have a volume down in the chamber whenever we could.
No, that was one. But you would have taken it personally because you could get angry.
I could get angry, yeah. But if I got angry with everything negative that was said about me or the team, then I would have spent most of my life being pretty upset and disappointed. I mean, I was never one, really. I never shied away from reading newspapers or listening to the commentary because I always felt that there's things you could learn, even if it was negative stuff that was being said. There's always positives you could take from any of that stuff. So, to be honest, I mean, you look back at years and years of cricket broadcast in Australia, and I think back to when I was a very young boy in primary school. As soon as that bell went, I'd be grabbing my bag and running out and running home as quickly as I could to turn the television on and listen to and watch the broadcast of Test match cricket or one day cricket here in Australia. So I've got lots of fond memories from that. But I think it's probably a worldwide thing that happens now that whenever you're in the change rooms, even if you're not waiting to bat, the volume is normally turned down on the television.
Do you remember how hard it was to play now that you're a commentator? I mean, it wasn't as hard for you to play as it was maybe for Damien Fleming. Shut up, mate. Or myself, certainly. But I go there first. But do you look at it now and go, okay, there's a drop catch or there's a poor shot or whatever, but is it in the back of your mind that it's actually a very, very tough game to play?
Absolutely, yeah. And I think, if I'm ever critical in the commentary box, I always try and put a positive spin on what it's all about and try and explain how difficult some of those things might be. It's, you watch the game of cricket on television with everything slowed down as much as it is, it looks like the easiest game in the world. Facing a spin bowler, you think, how would you ever get out, the average guy watching on the broadcast, I think, how would you ever get out to a spin bowler? But the game's a bit more difficult than that. So I think that's one of the things you learn as a past player and then into the commentary box is you have to do whatever you can to explain situations to the best of your ability and maybe bring the less educated cricket lover a little bit closer to what the players actually go through. So that's what I've tried to do with a lot of the Big Bash stuff, and as I said, some of the test cricket that I've commentated is just make it feel like the person sitting in the lounge room chair at home is actually sitting in the change rooms or out in the middle taking part in the game.
It's fitting, the grand final day, which has been extraordinary out here at the MCG and been a great product, amazingly broadcast by Channel 7 over the journey. That finishes, and we fly straight into a women's cricket one-day international Australia-New Zealand in Sydney.
It's amazing just to think where the whole game has come. I mean, I've been really privileged to sit back and watch the way the women's Big Bash has sort of grown almost day on day over the last few years, and the amount of broadcast time now that the women are getting is absolutely fantastic, and it's something that's thoroughly deserved. And cricket's obviously been a front runner in broadcast of women's sport. So to watch that grow and evolve over the last couple of years has been fantastic. And to think that you could sit back and watch the AFL Grand Final then turn on a women's international game of cricket in the same day. It'd be pretty special. I know Dave Byron will be up here a bit later talking about some of the other things that will happen through the course of the summer, but there's some pretty exciting stuff happening.
What are your expectations from this patched up Australian team for the coming summer? We've got obvious absentees. We're going to hear from Tim Payne a little later on, but what do you think is going to happen?
Look, I said the other day in Sydney, I honestly and very strongly believe that if the Australian cricket has got the best depth of any cricket playing nation in the world. The fact that even looking back to the last few weeks of the one-day series that was just played in England, although the boys lost 5-0, you know, on the back of it, and the new captain, the new coach coming in, that opportunity was probably six of the top starting 11 out of the side, presented a great opportunity for some of the younger guys, which they would have learnt a lot, even though they lost those five games over there. They would have learnt a lot about themselves and about the international game, and that will hold them in good stead for a World Cup that's just 12 months away. I'll start about the one-day team first. You add six guys into that team that played in England last week, and I guarantee you when the World Cup comes around that there'll be a lot of sides worried about what that Australian cricket team is capable of. So I'm really excited for what the white ball format of the game holds for us, but there's obviously a huge challenge with the summer as well, with India coming out to Australia. I mean, India are a very, very powerful cricket-playing nation that have got some of the best players in the world in their team at the moment. Normally, when you think about Indian cricket teams, you think about the strength of their batting and their spin bowling, but right now they've actually got a pretty handy pace attack as well. So one thing I think I'd like to see a bit more life left in the wickets here for the summer, and certainly that'll help our fast bowling game. It might help India's as well, but I think our batsmen will cope better against their quicks than their batsmen will cope against ours.
Well, you're still powerful enough in Australian cricket to make that happen.
And I'm retired now, so put as much grass on the wickets as you like. I don't have to bat on anymore.
Brad Coley, the game's best player?
Right now, yes, because Steve Smith's not there. But if Steve Smith were there playing now, then I'd have him as the number one player in the world, certainly batsman anyway. And then you look at some of our fast bowlers, we've probably got a couple of the top five or six fast bowlers in the world as well. So that's how highly in regard I hold Stephen Smith. And what he's done the last three or four years with his game and to be able to lead that Australian team to so many wins the way he did, especially that at the Ashes summer last year, was just some of the best and purest batting you'll ever see. And to do it on the big stage in the Ashes series and do it on the first day of the Ashes series when it counts the most says a lot about it.
You can debunk a bit of a myth to the great people assembled here about how hard it is to be the captain of the team. When you've got Langer and Hayden and then yourself and Martin and Mark Waugh and Steve Waugh and then Adam Gilchrist, and then if you ever get in trouble when you're out in the field, you've got Shane Warne and Glenn McGrath. It's not that hard.
Made it look pretty good, didn't I? All those blokes. Actually, I had Glenn McGrath with me in Sydney on Tuesday and he said he made me look really good as well through his career. But no, look, I was very, very fortunate not just to play in the year that I played and play with some of those names you just mentioned there, but to get a chance to captain those guys for as many games as I did. I mean, everyone probably sits back and thinks that I had those guys on my side for every game that I captained. I wish I did. I only had, you know, Warne McGrath for a few years, but it would have been nice to have them for a lot more. But, then some of those names you mentioned, I mean, Hayden, Lane, Martin, Gilchrist, you know, guys like Mike Hussey, you know, they were once-in-a-generation sort of players that I was lucky to play with, and as I said, share so many great memories with at the end of the day.
All right, what you've been amazing at, and not just yourself, but Flem and all the team assembled when Ten had the BBL, was bringing that competition to life. It's to watch and love the way it was done. It's now an extended season, and it's something you're incredibly passionate about, the shortest form of the game.
Yeah, well, I am, mainly because I've commentated most of that format of the game. I've had a chance to coach that format of the game as well with mixed results over the last couple of years. I might be doing a bit more commentary the way the coaching stuff's going. But, no, to be honest, look, having come out of playing a little bit of T20 cricket at the back end of my career and then going straight into the commentary box, I thought I had a reasonable idea about the tactics that go into it and some of the technical aspects that the modern players are working on a daily basis to improve themselves as modern T20 players. So, we've had a great time and we'll continue to have a great time with Channel 7 this year covering the Big Bash. And it's, we're so lucky here in Australia that the length of the tournament has been absolutely spot on. The level of cricket's been spot on. The facilities that we have here in Australia are second to none. And I think the most important part about it is you have the players speaking so highly of the game on a daily basis as well. And that's just not the Australian players. That's every single overseas player that comes to Australia speaks very, very highly about the Big Bash competition, which is not always an easy thing to do. So yeah, look, it's a great album and one that I'll continue to have a lot of fun working on.
All right, we're winding you up now, but we're at the MCG, of course, and as Tim said, you are a very, very passionate North Melbourne Football Club fan. Not as well run a club as it formerly was, but how are things going? Are you happy with the way your team are fronting up every week? Because you're not always happy.
I'm not always happy, and you're the first one to find that out most of the time when I'm sitting back at night having a few glasses of wine and finding it pretty easy.
Well, I think you must have had a lot with some of the texts I received.
Yeah, that's probably fair to say as well. Very fair to
you
say.
You sat pretty much every one of our playing group at one stage, didn't you? Well, you
most of them have been sacked at different times. I'd like to know how many remote controls I've actually smashed as well as trying them on the floor, but no, look, the club must be being run pretty well right now, James, and I'm surprised. Are you surprised about the on-field performance this year? Yeah, so Kangaroos just sitting out just outside that night. Big game coming up on the weekend, but it's been great as always to sit back and watch and not break quite as many remote controls this year.
Hey, well done. I know there was lots of signatures being sought after when it came to assembling commentary teams, but yours was at the very, very top for good reason, and we are absolutely delighted that you chose Channel 7. You're going to be a huge part of the coverage. Enjoy every second. Great chat.
Yeah, thanks, everyone. I can't wait for the summer to start. Thank you.
Thank you, Ricky Ponting, everyone.